Now, last class, we were talking about hyssop. And we were, just in a nutshell and very simply, I mean, we talked about the blood being applied with hyssop and just the fact that God requires us to be in a certain state of heart toward Him. But now we want to talk about hyssop in a little broader view. Leviticus 14, let me just read this. The chapter in the Bible where hyssop is mentioned the most is this chapter right here, Leviticus 14. Here the leper, remember last class, we ended talking about lepers. Okay? Interestingly enough, the leper offering is required that it be applied with hyssop. And that's why you had to go show yourself to the high priest. Remember those 10 lepers? Jesus said, go show yourself to the high priest. And as they went, they got healed. Do you remember that? One of them turned back and applied it with hyssop. You know? All right, so we're talking about the leper offering. All right, so this is, we're still talking about hyssop, but it applies to the leper. Here the leper and all his possessions are cleansed by blood and water that is applied with hyssop. In other words, the offer of cleansing was not enough, for it had to be applied with hyssop. However, the subject of cleansing of lepers introduces us to more than just the work of the blood, but brings in the fact of cleansing by water also. All is to be applied with hyssop, including the water. So the one new element that we're adding here, well, two new elements. One is, up to this point, we've talked about blood and hyssop, and the blood and the hyssop have always applied to your sins. Now we're talking about blood and water, not just blood, cleansing by blood and cleansing by water. Now, how many of you know automatically what that relates to in your New Testament walk? Well, you should. Cleansing by blood and by water, but this isn't being applied to sins. This is being applied to the person and his state. Okay? So, let's see, where was I? Leviticus 14, 2 through 7 gives us the requirements for the cleansing of a leper, not a sinner. Okay? A leper is one who's not just sinned a specific sin, but whose flesh is in danger of affecting others. So we see that leprosy does not just relate to the actions of a person, but to the state of the person himself. You know there's a difference between your actions and you, right? I mean, your actions are the result of you. If you're a leper, your actions are going to be leprous, right? All right, so from Romans 1 through 4, I'm talking about Romans chapter 1, 2, 3, and 4, we understand that the blood of Jesus has dealt with the issue of committing specific sins. And that's what Romans, the first chapter, second chapter, third and fourth, all the way through, that's primarily what they're dealing with is specific acts of sin. However, Romans 5 through 8 introduces us to another problem, which involves the nature of flesh that produces acts of sin in the first place, right? It is your flesh and the nature of flesh that produces deeds of sin. Men sin because they have a nature of sin. Do you agree with that? That's why we sin. All right, so to forgive sins while leaving the fallen nature, the leper in place, will only result in more sins in the future, meaning if you take blood and you take hyssop and you apply it to what he does wrong, you will forgive the acts of a leper, but he's still a leper. So this offering is trying to deal with the leper himself and not just the slime that he leaves behind. All right. The leper offering is a picture of God's method of dealing with more than just sins, but also with the person and his defiled state also. To be cleansed from sins, all you need is the blood to be applied with hyssop. But to be free from leprosy will require the addition of other things also applied with hyssop, because we're not leaving the subject of hyssop. And if you're wondering why we jump from the Passover and hyssop in the Passover to the leper offering, because we're continuing this thought of the use of hyssop. The cleansing of lepers in Leviticus requires two things, blood and running water. Okay? Blood and running water. This means that there are two cleansings. One cleansing is by blood and the other by water. As we shall see, both have to be applied with hyssop. All right, so here we go, Leviticus 14, 1 through 8. And the Lord spoke unto Moses, saying, this shall be the law of the leper in the day of his cleansing. He shall be brought unto the priest, and the priest shall go forth out of the camp. And the priest shall look, and behold, if the plague of leprosy be healed in the leper, then shall the priest command to take for him that is to be cleansed two birds alive and clean, and cedar wood, and scarlet, and hyssop, and the priest shall command that one of the birds be killed in an earthen vessel over running water. An earthen vessel. You ever heard that phrase before? But that earthen vessel has to be overrunning with water. Okay? As for the living bird, now remember it says you take one bird and you kill it over the earthen vessel that's running with water. Okay. As for the living bird, he shall take it and the cedar wood and the scarlet and the hyssop and shall dip them and the living bird in the blood of the bird that was killed over the running water. And he shall sprinkle upon him that is to be cleansed from the leprosy seven times and shall pronounce him clean. Notice, shall sprinkle upon him that is to be cleansed from the leprosy seven times and shall pronounce him clean. And shall let the living bird loose into the open field. And he that is to be cleansed shall wash his clothes and shave off all his hair and wash himself in water that he be clean. And after that he shall come into the camp, shall tarry abroad out of his tent 7 days. All right, so now you know that lepers back in those days could not come into the camp. They couldn't walk and mingle with the people. They had to walk through. Anytime they went around people, they had to walk around saying, unclean, unclean. Is that cool? If most of you would be honest about your spiritual state, you would be walking the hall saying, unclean, unclean. Amen? And you'd look rather zombie-ish while you're doing it. All right, the main elements involved in cleansing a leper, here's the primary things. You got to get this. Two birds with cedar wood, scarlet, and hyssop. And of course, the vessel overrunning with water. These elements have spiritual significance for us today. The example given in Leviticus was only a shadow of the true, which is fulfilled in the New Testament. In other words, we're supposed to be the walking, living, or walking and living in the fulfillment of it. These are the times of fulfillment, not the times of shadows anymore. Our responsibility is to find and live in the New Testament, or in the New Covenant reality. The two birds, they represent Christ in death and in resurrection, but as communicated by the Spirit, because they're birds. They represent death and resurrection as communicated by the Spirit. Wood in the Scripture, what does wood always represent? Humanity. And so wood in the Scripture represents humanity, but cedar wood represents Christ's humanity, which was a flesh that is strong and stable and not subject to the elements of normal wood. I don't know if you know much about cedar wood, but like on the ranch out there, we've got at Dove Ranch, we've got plenty of cedar trees growing, particularly on the back nine. Actually, it's almost that, the back nine. Cedar trees galore. And man, you just love making fences out of cedar trees, because if you take a regular tree limb and you make a fence out of it, especially if you leave the bark on it, it'll rot in no time. That represents our humanity. Wood represents our humanity. But you take a cedar tree, you can leave off the branch, you can leave the bark on it or off it. It takes forever to rot. I mean forever. That's why, I mean, the fences last, you know, hundreds of years. Bugs don't like cedar trees, so they don't eat it, whereas bugs and, you know, other stuff mess with you all the time. You know what I'm talking about? The Lord of the Flies and all this kind of stuff mess with you a lot. So that's why cedar wood represents humanity, because it's wood. but it represents Christ's humanity. It's strong and it's stable, and it's not subject to the elements like regular wood is, like regular humanity is. So it points to God in the flesh. And scarlet is a color that speaks of sacrifice. Hyssop represents the spirit in which it is offered. Okay, so there's all these elements, but now we realize that none of this is going to be important unless we apply it with hyssop. It's required. It's required. So the first bird was sacrificed in an earthen vessel whose cup runneth over. Water represents the washing of water by the word. Right? Ephesians 5? You do know that, right? I know you know it, Kelly. Let's see. Jonathan, did you know that? Water represents the washing of water by the word. Good enough. And so when it's talking about this running water and everything, it's bringing in this aspect of the word. So it's not stagnant water. Yeah, but moving water, ongoing, alive, living water. How about that? And that's a good description of when the scripture talk about out of your being shall flow living water. It's not just stuff that you've learned and it's stagnant in you. It's alive. It's flowing out of you. It's the word of God that's alive in you and coming out of you. There's a cleansing that takes place by means of moving water. In other words, have you ever seen a pond where there is no water moving? Scum builds up. Have you ever seen a Christian where there is no moving water? Scum builds up, you know. But you know what? Scum is actually cleansed away by moving water. Streams, man, it just keeps it all. I mean, streams that are flowing, the water is so clean and so cool and so fresh. And it's got a natural cleansing agent. So there's cleansing by the blood, and there's cleansing by water. Two different kinds of cleansing for two different situations. Most of us know the blood. But we're talking about more than that with the leper. All right, so the first bird is killed in the vessel while water runs over it. The blood joined in with the water, and they work together for cleansing. The blood and the water mingle together to work for cleansing. All right, turn to 1 John 5, verse 6. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 6. And we're going to read 6 through 8. Let me just begin. This is he that came by water and blood. Does this sound like what we're talking about here? I'm talking about Jesus. This is he that came by water and by blood, even Jesus Christ. Not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit. Here's the birds. It is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. And there are three that bear witness in earth: the Spirit, and the water, and the blood. And these three agree in one. So the water and the blood and the Spirit, as seen in the dead bird and the living bird, bear witness in one. One death, one resurrection, one person who went through both of those. So with the second bird, hyssop was taken, and the offerer sprinkled the bird both with the blood and water. Okay, this is the resurrection bird. It's taken, and it's sprinkled with both blood and water by means of hyssop. Okay? That's why last class, if you didn't get it, you're not going to get a lot of this here. And then it was set free. Now, what's he covered with? I mean, you got to think about these things. What is this spirit, I mean, this bird covered with? Water and blood. From this type and shadow, we understand that it is the application of the blood and water that makes us free in spirit from our leprosy or our old nature. This is bringing fruit. Now, that's just a shadow. There is a reality of the blood and the flowing water that the Spirit is supposed to bring us, that is supposed to make us free from our leprous state. Anybody ever looked within at ugliness within inside of you? This is the offering that'll free you up if you'll just try to comprehend what these elements are and what the Lord is trying to bring out here. And then we just read in the New Testament, John is saying, don't you see the fulfillment of this is right here, and this is how we're going to get free? See? He didn't just point to the old and say, well, that's what the Jews used to believe. He said, we believe this, but we believe it by Christ in the living reality of it and not the shadow of it. All right. Let's see. But notice that cleansing was not just by the blood or the water alone, but by the way that it was applied. The blood united with the water set our spirit free. Through the action taken toward the two birds, we see that there was a death to our spirit, to the leper. Because Jesus didn't just die for the fun of it, folks. He took us into death. You understand that? He didn't just die. He died so we would die. When that bird died, that was the Spirit taking us into Jesus' death so that we would die. We lepers die. So through the action of the two birds, we see that there was a death to our spirit, the leper, and a release of Christ's spirit within. There's a resurrection spirit, and that's not us. That's Christ's nature. That's Christ's spirit. We died in the earthen vessel. We died with Christ when he died on the cross. We died with the cedar wood. Jesus took us to death. Okay? So this witness is not by water only, but by water and by blood. One bird is free because the other one died. Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. There's the bird that died. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. There's the bird that set free. You see, these guys saw Jesus in all this Old Testament stuff. We just read scriptures and go, well, I guess that's the truth. I guess that's a new thing Jesus brought about. Now, the new thing is that he fulfills all that. We are crucified with Christ, as seen in the first bird, but we also have the release of Christ's life within, as seen in the second bird. As lepers who desire to be made free, any lepers in here that desire to be made free? As lepers who desire to be made free, we are to identify in Christ's death and resurrection, because these birds represent our joining to Jesus in his death and our being joined to him in his resurrection. That is our source of freedom from spiritual leprosy. Now, You know, this can just be facts. A leper could hear this and go, well, that ain't going to do nothing. You know, in the Old Testament, I'm sure some of them did. Man, I messed up. This ain't going to help. I got news for you. This will help, but you got to receive it with hyssop. It has to be applied with hyssop. If you're not broken, if you're not before the Lord on this, it's like when I was preaching in Africa one time to the pygmies. It all went over their head. Not really. I never preached to the pygmies in Africa. It just came to me. All right. So as lepers who desire to be made free, we are to identify in Christ's death and resurrection. That is our source of freedom from spiritual leprosy. Notice again that the three bear witness in one. The blood and water are joined, and then it is joined to the second bird and released. In other words, this flowing water, this blood that is shed, is applied to the resurrection bird. Not to you, but to you in Christ. Nothing's applied to you outside of union with Christ. That's the reality right there. So In God's reckoning, there's not just the blood or the water, but we are to bear witness to it for it to be effectual. That's why John is saying this. There is the water, and there is the blood, and there is the Spirit, but we must bear witness to this, and this is when we begin to apply these things with hyssop. This is when we begin to be brought into humility as Christ is lifted up instead of ourselves. This is when we're brought into death and allow Christ to be the one released, and yet Christ is our life within. If you partake of his Spirit, let me read this. You are supposed to receive it all in a humble spirit. Though Jesus' blood was shed 2,000 years ago and his word was given long ago, there is no release if there is no bearing witness to both blood and water. If you partake of his Spirit, then you also partake of blood and water. Because if you partake of the dove, he's got the blood and water. None of this is supposed to be applied in our lives unless it is done with hyssop, and our lives meaning our lives in union with Christ. The realities of the cross are seen in the blood. The realities of the cross, as seen in the blood, are mingled into the washing of the water by the Word, while the Spirit carries it to us. All of the realities of the cross are seen in the blood. All of the application of what Jesus did at the cross, seen in the blood. All of the reality of this is in the Word of God, and through it washes us with the blood, mingled together. As the Spirit carries it to us, we are made free from our leprosy. If we don't see it, if we don't bear witness to it, if we don't see it, if we don't experience it, if we're not bearing witness to it, and this is in the earth. Now, in heaven, there are a lot of things settled. The Father and the Son and the Spirit, Holy Spirit bear witness. But in the earth, these three bear witness to the heavenly reality that we're already joined into in Christ. So these three agree in one. The writer of Hebrews acknowledges the agreement of these three when he states, "How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself," bird number one, "purge," that's hyssop, "to serve the living God." That's the resurrected bird. You want me to read it again so you can hear that? "How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself," there's the first bird, he died, "offer himself, purge our conscience," there's purging is with hyssop, remember? "So that we can serve the living God, and we do that by the resurrected bird, Christ in us." Leprosy was considered to be a walking death. Can you imagine? I mean, some of you are going, "I don't have to imagine." So they got the shadow, I got the real thing. Our conscience is what bears witness to the release that comes as a result of these things. The conscience is purged from dead works and set free from a life of living as a leper unto the realm of the living. The leper dies in the first bird. We live in oneness. Not the leper lives, the leper dies. We live by the life of Christ by the second bird. A separation from one life takes place unto a new life. Both the offering of the red heifer and the leper offering have the element of the water of separation, where the word separates you from what you were. And this is, some of you have never studied the offering of the red heifer, and I've got a book that I wrote on it. But this water of separation is where the water begins to cleanse your conscience and your mind and your view, and you begin to be separated from what you were. That's why it can't just be by blood. You must wash your mind and your conscience in the living reality now. You must be a vessel where this water is being poured over you, and it's taking the blood with it. And you're being cleansed from your leprosy in the process. Also, we see in both offerings that all is applied with hyssop. It says this in Numbers 19 in relationship to the offering of the red heifer, and a clean person shall take hyssop. Not just a sinful person. Hyssop is required, yeah, all the way around. Not humble when you got a need, humble because the Lord is greater. And you always see your need in his greatness. It's an in-working flow that's always at work in you. So here you have all these elements. You've got blood and you've got water and you've got cedar wood and you've got, and it's, you have to carefully add all these ingredients if this offering's gonna come out right. You see what I mean? Because it's got ingredients. It'd be like, you know, cooking something and leaving out some major ingredient. Well, no wonder Christians are starving. They're eating stuff that's missing certain elements, you know what I mean? All right, this application of by hyssop is seen in the Old Testament concerning another leper. Who knows his name? Naaman is his name. And I'm just going to read this. Well, let's see where I'm at here. Not sure how much time I got, so I'm just going to read you the scriptures. It's out of 2 Kings 5, but I'll just read it to you. Cleansing was offered to him when Elisha told him to go wash in the Jordan River and he would be made clean. Remember that? Just in a nutshell, he was a Syrian, not from Israel. He was the captain of the host of the Syrians. In other words, he was a great man, but he was leprous. So it doesn't matter how high you get and how important you get and your status and all that. If you're leprous on the inside, you still, even though you lead all those people, you can't really get close to anybody. Hello, we're talking to somebody here. The Lord is, I'm not, you know. These things are important to our lives, and God sent you here, so. Cleansing was offered to him. So anyway, he comes to Elisha. He comes all the way to Israel and comes to Elisha. And Elisha doesn't even come out to see him. Elisha sends his servant and says, go wash in the Jordan River 7 times and you'll be made clean. And Naaman, because he's a great man, gets upset with this because Elisha didn't even come out of the door. And he just told him to go wash in one of Israel's waters instead of one of their waters. And he didn't like that, and he said, he left, and he left mad, and he took all of his entourage with him and said, you know, I thought he'd come out and clap his hands over his head and God would do an instant miracle, which is sounds like most modern-day Christianity, most churches, services, whatever. So he was told to go wash in the Jordan River and he'd be made clean. However, Naaman was the captain of the armies of Syria and was a very proud man. He had no place for hyssop in his life. Here's the quote. But Naaman was wroth and went away and said, behold, I thought he will surely come out to me and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God and strike his hands over the place and recover the leper. Are not Arbana and Pharpar rivers of Damascus better than all the rivers of Israel? May I not wash in them and be clean? So he turned and went away in a rage. He's got no place for applying any of this with hyssop, therefore he's missing out. However, one of his servants who came with him saw that pride and arrogance stood in the way of all that God had for him and encouraged him to humble himself in return. The scripture says, and his servants came near and spake unto him and said, my father, if the prophet had bid thee do some great thing, wouldest thou not have done it? How much rather than when he said to thee, wash and be clean? So then he went down and dipped himself. He humbled himself. Then he went down and dipped himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the saying of the man of God, and his flesh came again like unto the flesh of a little child, and he was clean. His whole life he spent as a leper. And the one thing that almost kept him from getting free from the junk that always messed with him was just the simple thing of humbling himself and getting in a state where he could receive. Because that's really the parable of the sower is the parable of the ground. It says the word of God is the seed. It's the same word. Everybody gets the same seeds. Some don't get better seeds. It's just some are more fruitful because some people's ground is hard. They're not soft. They don't have hyssop growing in their ground. They're not prepared ground. They're hard, and they got other things that their mind's on and everything else. And so all of that, you know, it'd be like me saying, I'm going to plant me a great harvest field, and I go out here and throw seeds on the concrete out here. And then wonder, why am I not getting the results that, you know, Farmer John over here is getting? I don't understand. I did everything he did, and I bought the seed, and I had the right seed. And it can be the perfect right seed. And it has nothing to do, and Jesus told that parable, it has nothing to do with the seed. It has to do with the condition of our heart to receive it. Are we there or not? If not, you know, if not, then we're wasting our time. Because it's landing, but it's not catching. Okay, so from this we can see that God not only cares what is applied, meaning blood and water, but how it is applied. Hyssop has its place in the process of cleansing. It is the part Naaman left out at the first. Eventually, Naaman returned and pulled up some hyssop as his means of applying the remedy. Do you see the applying it? You see, the hyssop doesn't, I keep trying to help you to see, the hyssop doesn't cleanse him. The blood does, the water does. In the case of the leper, the blood and water does. In the case of Israel coming out of Egypt, the blood does. But it is how it is applied that makes a difference. Hyssop has its, let's see, eventually, however, hyssop is not just meant for the ones in need of remedy, but also for the ones who are to apply the remedy. We see this in the case of the ashes of the red heifer. Tells us that a clean person shall take the hyssop. It was the clean person that was to be careful in applying the remedy with humility. Folks, this is all New Testament. This is the explanation of Galatians 6:1 that says, brethren, if any man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. See, we just think, well, that's a rule of the New Testament. No, that is the fulfillment of the Old Testament in relationship to lepers and in relationship to the Passover. All right, turn with me to Luke chapter 7. Here we're going to talk about a New Testament leper, a different one than we've talked about up heretofore. Luke chapter 7. And let's see, let me make sure here. I'm going to go to Mark chapter 14 and read the same one. They're both the same story, but I'm going to, Mark 14:6 says, and Jesus said, I'm going to read out of Mark 14, verse 3. It says, and being in Bethany in the house of Simon the leper as he was eating, there came a woman having an alabaster box. Okay, in Luke, and just to make sure you know that it's the same story, Luke 7 and verse 36. And one of the Pharisees, what was the Pharisee's name? Simon. He was a leper. But he was also a Pharisee. Is it possible to be a leper and a Pharisee at the same time? Well, the church is full of them. All right. And one of the Pharisees desired him that he would eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and sat down to eat. And behold, a woman in the city who was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment and stood at his feet behind weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and did wipe them with the hair of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now when the Pharisee who had bidden him saw it, he spoke within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known who and what manner of woman this is that toucheth him, for she is a sinner. And the other accounts talk about how the ointment filled the room. How it filled the room. All right, another example of a leper who knew nothing of applying blood with hyssop was Simon the leper. Which is worse, being a leper or a Pharisee? Never mind. The scriptures tell how he sits at a, how Jesus sits at a dinner table with Simon, but a harlot, because that's the actual Greek word there, a harlot comes in and throws herself at Jesus' feet and washes them with her tears and with her hair. Clearly, they both had problems that needed a remedy, right? They both had problems. One was a sinner and the other a leper. However, the leper looked down upon her, accounting that her actions were much worse than his state of being. And that's significant. He's looking at her actions, but his state is terrible. Did you know I see this all the time? I see lepers all the time putting down people for what they do to make them feel better. But their state is more messed up than the actions of some people. They live in a state of leprosy. But Jesus was greatly moved by her. He was not moved, but she was. The leper was not moved, but Jesus was. She broke with the thing she treasured most, and now Jesus was her treasure. The sweetness of her response toward Jesus filled the room. Am I right or wrong? The sweetness of her response toward Jesus filled the room. This action on her part was not the result of Christ in her. Right? Her breaking down, that wasn't Christ in her, but was her own heart responding to Jesus. Her deeds did not atone for her. Can I get an amen? What she did not atone for her, but they were memorable to the Lord. He called it a memorial. This will be a memorial to her. Memorial comes from the word memorable. And this action on her part, though it was not Jesus, it was somebody taking hyssop, it was memorable to Jesus. Jesus' memory of her would not be about her failures or about her profession, but the manner in which she came to him. Did you hear that? It won't be about her deeds or her profession, but about her heart and the way that she is with Jesus. That's pretty cool. That's a fair trade. A little hyssop, applying his blood. In contrast to the leper who was never cleansed, and he would probably not remember this leper, he would remember her brokenness and attitude of heart towards him. All right, so we want to talk a little more about this cleansing by blood and this cleansing by water. Hyssop represents having a clear recognition on our part concerning what God has done, that's number one, and then bowing ourselves before him with acceptance as to his view of things. Do we have a clear recognition of what he has done? Do we bow before him and give way to his view of things, even if we don't like it? Then that requires hyssop. Not just blood, not just the cross. It requires hyssop. To some degree, most Christians do this. They do this according to the blood. But they fail to apprehend the application of the water. Most of you in this room know about the blood and you believe it and you've applied it. But have you done that in relationship to the water? As discovered by the requirements in the leper offering, the blood does not stand alone, but there is also to be the element of water and spirit. Remember, these three bear witness in one. For example, in the Gospel of John, when Jesus died on the cross, do you remember? I'll read it. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he saw it, and he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knoweth that he saith true, that you might believe. And this is the same guy that wrote this, that wrote in John, these three bear witness in one in the earth. The water, the blood, and the spirit. So what does water pertain to? How do we apply it with hyssop? What is the meaning for our personal lives? Water pertains to a cleansing from our old view of things unto a mind renewed to our new identity in union with Christ. It is water washes the mind and renews the mind. Blood washes your sins away. Can you see that a person might actually, Jesus had died for them, and his blood be effectual, but because their mind is not renewed to it, they live in guilt? Could that be possible? Could it also be possible that God would want the blood and the water brought to you by the Spirit, the living Spirit, the resurrection Spirit? Do you understand what that means? Not the view of you on this earth, the view of you in resurrection. How precious is that? Though our old man was long ago crucified with Christ, now we are washed from self by means of the reality of union with Christ. Before you were born again, your old man was crucified with Christ. Am I right or wrong? Or did he die when you got saved? I got news for you. He died 2,000 years ago with Jesus on the cross. You say, well, how can that be? Because I still live in self, or I still lived in self. Though our old man was crucified long ago with Christ, now we are washed. Our mind is renewed and washed with the word. We're not just applying the blood. We're applying the cleansing that comes by water. We're washed from self by means of the reality of our union with Christ. This is a death to us also. Because when you wash, you know what? You wash you away. You wash the leper away. When that blood was shed, you died. And when you wash all the old remembrance of who you are away. It's a death. Can you see how that's a death? It's a death to you, but life for Christ in you. We are awakened to the fact that the leper is not just cleansed, but put away and given a new life. The leper is not just cleansed. The death of that first bird is your death. It is a death by water. As you begin to be renewed to it, it's a death by water. A cross death. Hallelujah. In this case, hyssop is not just in relationship to the blood, but we must humble ourselves concerning death with Christ and not just over our sins. The same one who humbled himself and said, Lord, forgive me a sinner, must say, Lord, forgive me of my old life. I accept your decision concerning me. I'm dead. And you are my life. And I humble myself to that. And I acknowledge it and I receive that. As stated earlier, the dove must take and apply the blood of Romans 1 through 4 with the water of Romans 5 through 8. If you know anything about it, Romans 1 through 4 deals with the blood, and Romans 5 through 8 deals with the putting away of the old man, and it is the washing of water that takes that away. renewal to what happened at the cross, not just through blood, but through death. So as stated earlier, the dove must take and apply the blood of Romans 1, chapter 1 through chapter 4, with the water of Romans chapter 5 through chapter 8, and it must be applied with hyssop. Two cleansings were a regular involvement for a priest at work in the tabernacle who continually dealt with blood at the altar and water at the laver. You remember? Are we priests? Well, what does that mean? Well, we had a whole course on that. What does it mean? Are we living that, or is that just a teaching? I mean, the priests regularly, you can't get past the door. The first thing you bump into is the altar, and the second thing is the laver. The altar is covered with blood, and the laver is full of water. I mean, and if you did any work at the altar, your next stop is water and cleansing by water. Every priest regularly flows in the realm of this witness by the Spirit of the blood and of the water. This work of water in conjunction with the blood can be seen in 1 John 1:7. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, meaning if we walk in the light as we are in him, as he is, and we are seen in union with him, we have fellowship one with another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. There's a cleansing by walking in the light of this, and there's a cleansing by the blood. One is cleansing away what you've done. The other one is cleansing away your old identity. Walking in the light as he is in the light is a flowing stream that washes away old concepts concerning our identity. Remember that the flow of water also had the blood mixed in at the same time. And that concoction is what the Holy Spirit uses to cleanse us. It's quite a little concoction there, isn't it? This is the understanding of the phrase, the washing of regeneration and renewing by the Holy Spirit, found in Titus chapter 3. Okay, we're leaving our generation and we're going to Jesus's regeneration. We've been regenerated. We're left our identity by our first birth and we're going to the new one. We're being regenerated. Can you see how that is a washing? It takes you're not gonna agree in one unless you also agree with the water. You can agree with the blood all you want, but you're not agreeing in one. And these three are bearing witness in one. So you have to see how that's a washing. The blood is the proof of the death of our first generation, Galatians 2:20. And the water declares the coming forth of his generation, Galatians 2:20. Right? I am crucified with Christ. That's the declaration of the death of our generation. Nevertheless, I live, but not I, Christ liveth in me. That's the declaration of his generation. It's all agreeing in one. When the resurrection bird is released, he's free to bring us the reality of God that he is bathed in. He's covered in this. This is what is all over him. If he's going to come to you, this is what he's going to come with. You know? And the scriptures proclaim, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Hallelujah. The freedom of the Spirit is found in him being free to carry this freedom to us. What is the freedom that the Spirit brings to us? By the blood, our sins are removed. But by the washing of the word, we are awakened to the fact that by the cross, the leper is removed and now has a new life. Christ in you. That's freedom. Freedom from leprosy, folks. And freedom from slime of leprosy. Slime being the sins. Freedom from the slime of the leper by the blood. Freedom from being a leper by the water, as brought to us by the Spirit, sponsored by the Holy Spirit. The Spirit, by means of the Word, shows us that we are no longer lepers, but Christ is our life. David knew he also had a greater problem than just his sins. When he stated in Psalm 51, same one, about his, he knew he had a greater problem than sins when he said, I was shapen in iniquity and in sin than my mother conceived me. He knew he was a leper. Do you see that? I was shapen and sin was my, he knew he was a leper. And that's what he's saying when he says that. He was open to cleansing by blood and by water. Purging will require the water of the word, which reveals Christ by the Spirit and puts truth in the inward parts. Thou desirest truth in the inward part. Christ in us is the cleansing from the old man or from the leper. Did you hear what I just said? Christ in us is that's a cleansing right there. When it's him in us, we've been cleansed because the old is dead. You know? You don't have to fight off the old man, just live Christ. David uses both the phrase purge me and also the phrase wash me. Purge me of this leper. Wash me in the blood and I will be whiter than snow. That's his words. David also said in Psalm 51, thou desirest truth in the inward parts. Clearly he was aware of a deeper need than just forgiveness. Right? Because when you say God desires truth in the inward part, that's more than just I did something wrong. Soon, he says, purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. By the use of hyssop, he was admitting that he was not just a sinner, but a leper conceived in sin. He was open to cleansing by blood and by water. See, he could have just stuck with wash me thoroughly, wash me of my sins. He did say that, folks. But then he moves into the purging by hyssop part, and he moves into the water part, and he starts declaring that, you know, you want truth in the inward part. I was conceived in, and he starts declaring a whole nother thing. I'll read this phrase again. David uses both the phrase purge me and also the phrase wash me in that, let's see. In that same psalm, David continues to appeal both to blood and water when he says, and blot out all mine iniquities. That's blood, right? Then he says, okay, consider these words. Blot out my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart. Do you see? What a leap. One's getting rid of something, the other one's adding something. The blood removes something. The water renews you to something. The blood removes what you did wrong. The water renews your mind to Jesus as your life and to all that you have as a new creation in Christ Jesus. Create in me, he said, a clean heart. A clean heart. He's saying, instead of unclean, like a leper, wasn't that the words that they said? Unclean. He's saying, create in me a clean heart so that I can walk around saying, clean. You know, wouldn't that be cool? Wouldn't it be cool if every leper that Jesus ever healed walked the streets of Jerusalem saying, clean. People come over, what? You're not just forgiven. You're different. Yes, I've been cleansed from what? Clean what? Clean heart. I've been cleansed from my filthy leper heart. And what is the new covenant? I will put a new heart in. That's his heart. But if you're not renewed to that, you're going to act like a leper and claim these things. Can I get an amen from anybody? You'll be just like one of them faith people. Oh, I don't need no hyssop. I don't need to get down and seek the Lord in this. I don't need to count everything lost that I could know Jesus, my God. And that's, again, that's not Jesus at work in him. That's him committing to know Jesus till Christ is formed in him. That's a major dose of hyssop. Isn't it? Praise God. So, he says, create in me a clean heart. Renew within me a right spirit. There's water. the renewing. He said the regeneration, the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit. That's the dove bringing the blood and the water. The renewing of the, renew in me a right spirit. Well, you need to be renewed. Your mind needs to be renewed. You don't, he's not going to do something in you. He's going to awaken you to what he has done in you. All right, so the water washes away my identity and reveals Christ in me. But remember, all that pertains to blood and water is not just to be passively accepted as fact, but to be applied with hyssop. Therefore, David says, the sacrifices of God are a broken spirit and a broken and contrite heart thou wilt not despise. He claims the blood in his Psalm 51. And he claims the water clearly, powerfully. And then he applies them both with hyssop. The sacrifices of God are broken and contrite heart thou wilt not despise. This is applying all we have talked about with hyssop. When they offered bulls and goats, these were not God, what God was after, but the spirit in which was given. Remember? Sacrifice and offering thou desirest not, but nothing we give to God has any value to atone for us unless it is Christ. So here's, I'm just going to sum this up. Nothing we give to God has any value to atone except Christ. Do you agree? Blood, his death on the cross, what spiritual sacrifices by Jesus Christ, acceptable by Jesus Christ. Nothing has the ability to atone except it be by Jesus Christ. However, we can be that small, insignificant stick of hyssop that receives the Lord in a meek and quiet spirit. It's simply, yes, Lord. You know, I remember Peter talked about that, but he's talking about men and women. But it's the truth of hyssop. It's the fact of applying this stuff. That a woman receives it in meek and calling her husband Lord. Well, folks, we got a husband and his name's Jesus. And whether you're male or female, he calls the shots. We don't. We don't make the decisions. We're supposed to be the bride with a meek and quiet spirit. And I look, I'll guarantee he will tell us stuff that's contrary to what we want. Do you know that? He will do that. Do you love him? Do you love him supremely? You know. Oh, no, I love my dog. You know. No, I love my sports team. No, I love. But it's going to take hyssop on our part to really have these things applied in our life. And you know what? He's going to send things our way just to check where are we at. Doesn't he? He does that. He sends things our way just to check. And, you know. And we think it's, you know, we're all, because we're always so worried about loss. And that is nothing but selfishness at work in us. Can anybody say amen to that? Loss is nothing but the consideration of ourselves. We shouldn't be considering loss. We should be considering him. And our joy to be with him where he's at instead of trying to always get him with us where we're at. But I need you now. I want something now. But I got to have this now, you know. I mean, I don't see the bride of Christ being some whiny, pompous, self-centered, proud poodle. Can I get amen? Maybe you love poodles. I'm sorry. I'm from Texas. And that's fine. Good. Have your poodle. But I'm telling you, as a wife, you don't want no poodle. And I'll tell you, more importantly than that, the Lord doesn't want a poodle wife that goes, "Hey, I'm prissing over here, don't disturb me." You know, are you a dog or a cat? You know, that's what I'd say to my dog if it's over there prissing. "Well, yeah, it's taking care of myself, you know, it's looking good." Let's take care of the Lord. Do we love the Lord supremely? If we don't, folks, everything else is out of order and then we're all in trouble. That's the truth. Did I run out of time? Well, I'm going to. Thank you for putting up with my reading. And Lord willing, my next classes will be very much a flow from full. I spent all day with the Lord, but I knew I was very behind on my lessons. And I mean, from the time I got up almost, well, it was, from the time I got up till the time I got ready to come here, I spent in preparation for the coming classes and did not realize until the last hour that this class I had not spent enough time with and had to actually do some changes and then put it in the computer and then print it out in this form. So I apologize. Most of you who've been around here a long time know that I hardly ever do that. But it was just one of those things that skipped. And the next 28 classes will be on the burnt offering. So we're dismissed. Because I'm prepared.